Welcome to Conquest Chapter 7. This is the second part of an ongoing series where six of us pass around a Conquest Lunatic save file. We take turns completing one mission at a time before passing the save on to the next person in the chain. For those of you that are following the series here from Zoran's channel, welcome. My name is Balk, and I am bad at life. I'm probably the least experienced in this group with Conquest Lunatic, but my channel's got quite a few videos on optimizing birthright that you should check out. Zoran just sent me a save file from right after completing Chapter 6. According to the rules, each of us has to forfeit all of our decision-making power to the next player, right after completing our map. This means I hold a substantial amount of power. First of all, do I buy the armory or the staff shop? In the context of this playthrough, this is a bit of a no-brainer. I want to seize control over this playthrough at every opportunity I can. The best way to do that from this position is to buy the staff shop. This shop gives me access to class-changing seals.
Allow me to...
In particular, I'm getting one of only two heart seals that will be available until the end of Chapter 13. Every character has access to a different class using this item, and this class change can only be reverted by spending another heart seal. It's not an exaggeration to say that this one item can change the course of an entire playthrough. So of course, I'll be the one to use it, but not yet. This heart seal isn't all I'll be buying in the shop, but I'll need a bit more money. The goddess icon sells for 1,000 gold. This gives us enough to buy a master seal. I also have the option to sell the concoction and the vulnerary bundle from the branch of fate. This can buy me some tonics, though I'll pass on doing that for now. I've got all I need to start this chapter now, but there are still a few things I want to do before I give up control.
Now.
First, let's talk with Jacob to do a bit of redecorating. This file has maxed out resources already, so we won't be bothering with getting food or ore. Since Ariel is lazy and doesn't want to walk, we'll have Jacob bring our next stops closer to us. We aren't banning the use of my castle features this run, so I'll be making my first stop at the private quarters. Sometimes, the day-night cycle works out to let you use it immediately after completing Chapter 6. We weren't so lucky this time though. This can be solved by waiting a few hours, but I'll be passing on that. Let's just take this opportunity to change Ariel's hair. You're only able to change your hairstyle and accessory, not the other cosmetic features that get chosen at the Branch of Fates, so we'll be sticking with everything else about Ariel. And yes, even after we rank up our support with Jacob, the private quarters still don't open up. Moving on, our last stop in our castle will be a visit to Lilith. She is the most easily accessible source of unlimited gold in the game. Every third time she gets fed, she gives out a gold bar. The stats she grows are completely determined by the food she's given, though since she's confined to my castle and isn't even player controllable, this is almost never relevant. Coming back to Jacob, let's clean up after ourselves and get ourselves a nice clean field we can run around in. The Izumiti castle style is perfect for this. Nothing's in our way besides the giant central stone pillar.
Is there a plan?
I'm also obligated to show my birthright bias by bringing in a more appropriate song for the setting. And what castle would be complete without a sniper looking over it? Of course, I've got to rename the castle after myself. How else will I have an excuse to remind you to subscribe to my channel? With all that out of the way, it's finally time to move on to the map. First, I'll be removing Dragonfang from Zoran. We don't want her to get kills she'd barely get an experience from. I'm also unequipping Jacob's Iron Dagger. He often ends up critting with his dual strikes and killing Faceless. And finally, I'll be having Corn equip the Dragonstone. This minimizes our chances of getting crits. From here, we can get started. The first thing we'll be doing is getting Corn in range of two Faceless in the south. She'll be supported by Jacob, who will be giving her a whole range of buffs. First is his personal skill, Evasive Partner. It gives her 3 points of damage reduction and 15 avoid. He also has an aura from the male Troubadour class that grants an extra 2 points of damage reduction. Him just standing next to Corn during combat also gives her an extra 10 points of hit. This gets her to a hit rate of 100%. Unfortunately, the C rank support between Corn and Jacob also grants Corn 3 extra points of crit. Since Faceless have no luck to boost their crit avoid, this brings Corn's chance of outright killing each of them to 6%. The experience rating in this clear I'll be doing is pretty tight. I'd rather feed these kills to units that will gain more from it. This turn, we want to get Corn in range of both of the Faceless approaching from the west. There's one particular spot we can drop her to that both Faces can reach from two angles, so Jacob will be leaving her there. These Faceless have Grizzly Wound. This means any combat we have against them that isn't lethal will cause us to lose a fifth of our health. Since Corn's taking zero damage from nearly every enemy in this map just from standing next to Jacob, this isn't a concern for her. Although, this is a great way to farm experience for a certain Troubadour we'll be getting soon. At the start of turn 3, we get two new recruits, Silas and Elise. Silas is one of the best units in the game. We'll be spending this turn positioning to funnel as much experience as we can afford to him. The Faceless do zero damage to Corn. Enemy AI generally prefers to attack the units they deal the most expected damage to. As long as there's someone else in range they can deal damage to, they'll ignore Corn. Silas will be the punching bag for three of them. We'll be having Elise stand next to him so he can benefit from her personal aura, Elise Poise. The first Faceless attacks Elise and deals a lot of damage, but this also body blocks the other Faces from attacking her again. The next three Faceless will be attacking Silas. On top of his 10 base defense, he's got 3 points of damage reduction from Elise's aura, and 3 more from his personal skill now that Corn's HP is below half. This brings the enemy's damage down from 19 per hit to just 3. Of course, if we were using Felicia instead of Jacob, her aura could even bring the damage she's taking from each hit down to just 1. Using Felicia also makes it easier to bring Corn's HP low enough to activate Vow of Friendship. The 15 points of avoid Jacob gets to Corn aren't really great when we want Corn to take damage. Finally. It's the dawn of a new turn. We finally have access to the unit we'll be using our heart seal on. We're finally getting ourselves another mounted unit. That unit is, of course, Arthur. Turning Arthur into a Cavalier fixes some of the biggest issues he has out of the box. First of all, it gives him the option to use the Bronze Lance that Silas had. This brings his displayed hit from an abysmal 89 to a more acceptable 103. In addition to increasing Arthur's reliability when hitting things, the Bronze Lance also acts as a layer of protection from catastrophic failure. Arthur has what might just be the worst personal skill in the game. It's fortunate. This reduces his crit avoid by 5 points, meaning he's extra susceptible to being crit by normal enemies. His abysmal luck base and growth means this isn't going to change very soon. Fortunately for us, bronze weapons grant their users 10 points of crit avoid, cancelling out the drawback of Misfortunate and then some. The crit avoid penalty isn't the only downside to Misfortunate though. The skill also reduces the crit avoid of enemies within 2 spaces by 15 points. At first glance, this might seem like a great upside, but in Fates, there are a lot of cases where critical hits aren't desirable. Getting a kill when you don't expect one can mess with experience distribution as I mentioned before, but critical hits can also reduce the amount of guard gauge you get. Killing an enemy in a single hit instead of 2 hits can significantly reduce your bulk in the beginning. And killing an enemy you don't expect with a crit can also get a unit to see more combos than they normally would during an enemy phase. After all, dead enemies can't block squares. Bronze weapons are completely unable to crit, which solves this problem for Arthur. The Cavalier class also gives Arthur two of the best skills in the game. Elbow Room, which provides a flat +3 damage when he's not benefiting from terrain effects, which is going to be active most of the time, and Shelter, which allows him to spend his actions to allow someone else to act more than once. Being a Cavalier also gives Arthur 7 movement. This gives him, and my preferred choice for his wife, Effie, a lot more positioning options when choosing which enemies to engage. Despite all the benefits this class change gives Arthur, you could argue that it makes the team we're using as a whole worse. By taking Arthur out of the fighter class, we're losing out on the 4 strength and 2 speed pair bonus that can make wonderrunning a lot easier. By taking away this resource, the players with more experience in this game are going to have to make some changes to how we approach future maps. And that's a good thing in my eyes. I wouldn't want this playthrough to just evolve into people clearing maps in the same ways we've seen before. This is the reason why I haven't spent the hard sales to get Elise on a wyvern or Jacob on a horse. There are plenty of playthroughs that have routed the game extensively around them, but Cavalier Arthur hasn't gotten nearly as much love. The people I'm playing with are pretty good at this game. I'm really interested in seeing how they'll make him work. There are still some options beyond Cavalier Arthur that still haven't been excessively explored yet, but I don't think the first art seal is worth using on them in the context of this playthrough. In the previous video on Zoran's channel, he was egging me on to turn Korn into an Omiyoji. Before starting this run, we found that with an Omiyoji pair up in magic and speed tonics, Odin can win around every single generic enemy in his joining chapter. While this is definitely entertaining, Odin soloing the rest of the game by holding forward and killing everything isn't really the most engaging thing to watch. I am at least going to do my part in perpetuating the myth that Conquest is a game that's player phase focused, as you can tell by the many times I've done a player phase attack during this clear. The unit that Zoran expected me to use the hard seal on and that I falsely teased in the thumbnail is Effie. Effie's hard seal class is Troubadour, a class that fixes her issue of being limited to 4 move, but at a significant cost. Troubadours are stat locked. Their only way of getting experience is through healing or through status stabs. Finding targets to heal isn't difficult, but leveling up staff locked units requires a lot of time, a lot of heal and mend stabs. Those costs add up. A reclassed Effie effectively just becomes worse Elise. She doesn't have an amazing personal aura, and she doesn't even take hits better. There might be some niche uses for her as an extra 7 unit staff user, but reclassing Effie into Troubadour is effectively turning a potentially useful unit into a useless one. This would really restrict the strategies we have for early game maps. The same can be said about reclassing Silas into Mercenary. Not only would he lose the movement options given to him by having 7 move and access to Shelter, he'd also be unable to use any of the weapons we currently have until we buy the armory. This isn't to say that Effie and Silas' secondary classes are useless. That's definitely not true. In fact, if I have things my way, I'll be having Effie ending the Troubadour class line. If we're able to marry Effie to Arthur, she'll be able to use a partner skill to reclass into Hero. She'll get HP +5 and Soul in this class. She can bring these into the Maid class and become a 1-2 range juggernaut, just like Ninja Silas. The boss of this chapter is significantly more threatening than the other faceless. It's got 26 attack instead of 19. That's not enough to kill Silas Akorin, though the boss's Savage Blow and Grizzly Wound won't be kind to any unit he tries to attack. As you can probably tell by now, I'm using this chapter to get Arthur to level 10. This will let us promote him. He's got 2 options here, but the choice is obvious. Great Knight has some very significant upside over Paladin for Arthur. The most obvious is its access to axes. This lets him make use of the D-rank axes he started with. On top of this, it gives him more defense. This means if he does get crit, the consequences won't be quite as catastrophic. If he's able to marry Effie, he'll get defense +2 just by leveling up. That's really nice to have. Early promoting Arthur also has the added benefit of accelerating our ability to get funny crit builds. He can go into the front lines and apply his personal skill to reduce the crit avoid of nearby enemies. He won't be targeted by them thanks to his high defense. Instead, enemies can be drawn by a unit that stands next to him. Ideally, this is a Berserker with Gamble equipped, holding a Killer Axe. I recommend using a Heart Seal on Berserker for this, though using a Partner Seal on Effie also works. Arthur gives a 20-point hit boost in attack stance from an A-rank supports, and this can even go up to 30 points at S-rank. If you want to get even more spicy, you can even throw Selene into the mix to provide crit dual strikes, just in case the lead unit's crit doesn't kill. I forgot to have Jacob equip his weapon so he could debuff the boss in enemy phase. This won't stop us from being able to feed the boss heal with Silas though. The boss takes a lot of damage from Horn's dual strikes. We'll want to be using this to chip and eventually kill the boss. Horn's hit rates for these dual strikes are shaky though. We'll be helping her up by having Elise use freeze. This doesn't quite bring her hit rate up to 100% though. The Faceless is getting an avoid bonus from the terrain, but that's not going to stop me from trying for the kill. With the boss out of the way, we can start focusing on leveling up Arthur. Arthur's finally reached level 10. It's finally time to promote him. We're not quite done with this chapter yet though. There's still so much more experience that can be gained this chapter. The amount we get is only limited by the amount of heal stabs we have, which in this case is 2. I would have bought more, but if you remember, we don't have any money left. I'll just be bringing us down to 10 uses while grinding up Elise. Yes. With that, Chapter 7 is done. The next stop for the save file will be with Brainiac 327. Make sure you're subscribed to him as well as the rest of us doing this run. Links to all of our channels will be in the description. Until next time, my name is Balk, and I am bad at life.